Masih, thanks for joining us. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much. I'm so excited.
Look, I want to get, of course, to everything happening on the ground in Iran. But first, I want to ask you about the World Cup, because, of course, extraordinary scenes in Iran that you posted about, Iranians celebrating in Iran.
Can you believe that?
Because they were defeated by the United States. Okay, explain this to me, please.
I know it's very embarrassing for the Islamic Republic, but it's beautiful, actually. For years and years, the Islamic Republic actually brainwashed us to say death to America. I mean, I myself, I grew up in a tiny village. I was told that I have to shout death to America as loud as the White House could hear us. Now you hear that people in the street were holding the flag of America, celebrating the US victory, because it means that the Islamic Republic is kicked out from World Cup. And it means that the Islamic Republic doesn't have a global platform anymore to normalize its murderous regime. The World Cup, I mean, it was a platform for Iranians if the football players, like, showing solidarity with Iranian people. Before coming to World Cup, all of them, they went to the mass murderer, Ebrahim Raisi, they bowed to him, they shook his hand. So, believe me, the football team doesn't represent Iranians. It does represent the gender apartheid regime.
Now, the Iranians, the young Iranian men on this team did seem very sympathetic. I saw that they were, the first time around, they were not singing the national anthem, then they're threatened, then they sing it in a wooden way. Some of them were crying afterwards. The American players were supporting them, in some cases even embracing them. Did any of that come through in Iran at all? I mean, did the Iranian people see any of that?
Look, I'm a woman. You're talking to a woman who's been kicked out from stadiums to watch football for 40 years. And you want me to have sympathy with these male football players who never, never stood up for women in Iran? I mean, imagine it was not women of Iran. It was women here in America being kicked out from stadiums. Would you really celebrate your national team? This is not a national team. Right now, Iranian people are actually leading one of the historical revolution, led by women, supported by men. And this is the time that many well-known athletes, they're quitting their job. Many well-known actresses, they're quitting their job. So this is the moment that we want to see that football players using global platform, like bravely saying that, holding the pictures of Mahsa, holding the pictures of children getting killed, and going to different media talking about.
And that they did not, certainly.
They
do.
Didn't.
They did not do.
And don't forget that. Yeah. Before coming to the World Cup, as I told you, they shared the story of the Ayatollah, supreme leader of Iran. They shook the hand of Ebrahim Raisi. They actually showed their sympathy with Qasem Soleimani. These are something that you cannot forget that, you know? Yeah. And that is why we call on international sport federations to take a strong action. You know, Putin's football team, they got expelled from World Cup. What is different between Putin and Khamenei? You tell me.
Well, I mean, one invaded a sovereign country.
By whose help? Khamenei sending drones to Putin.
True, that is true. But I'm simply saying that there is, on the international stage, having invaded a neighboring country does
trust me, my brother,
create an action.
Islamic Republic invaded Iran.
I understand that. So I want to leave sports and talk about the situation on the ground in Iran. It's obviously the very inspirational, the footage that we've seen of all of these particularly young people, particularly young women, on the streets, very courageous. Also been a lot of repression, also been a lot of brutality, kids killed, people killed. And yet, there's clearly a differential response that we're seeing in different parts of the country. Why has there been as much restraint as there has for a regime that is capable of such brutality?
To be honest, I think that the Islamic Republic knows that if they now kill people, like the more that they kill, the more that people get determined to take back to the street. The more that they kill, the more people get angry to take back to the streets. And the reason that they kill people in the cities of Kurdistan, it's because it doesn't get much media attention. But immediately when people get killed in Tehran, big cities in Isfahan, Shiraz, so people can reach out to international media, and that's why there actually people are massacre happening in Zahedan. Only in one day, like 70 people got killed. Only in one day, they were praying. They were all shot in their back. Children got killed. So it didn't get that much media attention, you know? So that's the reason. But I have to say that right now, a lot of people believe that if the world, the like leaders of democratic country, if they don't take a strong action, they will open fire and the massacre is gonna happen.
So
like 2019.
Like 2019. So in terms of the Kurdish region, is the fact that the Iranians are willing to massacre people in the open public, does the rest of the Iranian population have the same level of solidarity for a minority region as they would Tehran, for example?
This is the first time in our history that we see a sense of unity among Kurds, Turks, Baluch, Arabs, and it's very beautiful for the first time that you hear when people get killed in Kurdistan. In Zahedan, people chant that Kurdistan Tanhani and Zahedan Pashtivani. It's a very touching and emotional slogan saying that Kurdistan, you're not alone. Zahedan is with you. Tehran is with you. This is the first time, and that unity actually scares the regime.
The Supreme Leader has taken a personal interest in you relatively recently after your appearance with my friend Bill Maher. There was a threat that was made directly against an American agent. He was referring to you. معلوم شد وقتی شما می‌بینید که عنصر سیاسی آمریکایی این قضایا رو به دیوار برلین تشبیه می‌کنه. How did you respond to that?
First of all, I'm not an American agent. I have agency as a woman who grew up in the Middle East. But if I was an American agent, I had to support the nuclear deal, no? I was against
that
deal.
That just makes you a very sneaky American agent, that all that, you know.
I know, but it's just, look, they call me American agent, the agent of CIA, the agent of MI6, the agent of Mossad. I don't get it. I mean, I don't have time to work for different agents.
But they also threatened you.
Yes, not only me, my family. They put my brother in prison for 2 years to punish me. I was very depressed that time because he didn't do anything, and I was under pressure to stop my work, which is giving voice to voiceless people. They brought my mother, they interrogated her for 70-year-old mother for 2 hours to convince her to take me to Turkey. They did everything to make me miserable, but clearly they're scared of me, and they're scared of my platform because I give voice to millions of Iranian brave leaders inside the country.
And you're no longer able to live in your home.
Yeah, I'm a village girl, you know, which my father and my mom, they were street peddlers. They were growing vegetables and selling the vegetables to the city, people in the cities. I grew up in that community, so I made my house in Brooklyn like my village. I planted trees after my mother's name, after my brother's name, after my father's name. Now I have to be even away from my garden, from my neighbors. And I'm not as scared of my life, but this is very scary that you see in front of the eyes of free world, the Islamic Republic sent people here in New York to kill you, to assassinate you, to kidnap you. This is scary. That shouldn't, I mean, I left Iran because I wanted to use my freedom of expression here in America, but it seems that even America is not safe.
So our audience understands. I mean, you have been moved now to, if I understand right, three different safe houses by the Americans.
I'm still living in safe houses.
So I can't, you won't even tell me where you're living.
No,
right now.
I can't invite you when.
No, that's okay. But
when the Islamic Republic is gone and we are safe, I can invite you to Iran. Yeah. But here, it's so sad that the word safe is too luxury. Not for me, for many Iranian dissidents. Their lives are in danger. Not even in New York, in Canada, in Turkey, in different cities across Europe. People are not safe. Why? Why? I mean, I cannot believe that. I'm asking why, but I know the reason. You want me to tell you why?
Yeah, you might as well.
Because the Iranian regime, when they don't see any consequence, when they're not being punished for all the assassinations and terror attacks that they have done before, there's no reason for them to stop killing people, assassinate people, no? I think that there are a lot the West can do to stop them, could do. They didn't. For instance, in my meeting with Secretary Pompeo, with Secretary Blinken, I met with all the leaders here, with Jake Sullivan, and I was clear that why there is no mention about human rights under 12 conditions of nuclear talk? Why? Why you easily bury human rights under nuclear deal? So that's why when the Iranian regime see that still the U.S. send billions of dollars to the Revolutionary Guards, then there's no reason for them to...
You're talking about the unfreezing of the Iranian assets when the initial deal was signed.
Exactly.
Yes, okay.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And look, Iranian regime now is very desperate. The only thing can make them survive, it's the U.S. government and its allies to get back to the deal.
And yet, you know, everything they've done on the ground to the Iranian people make it almost inconceivable that the Americans would be willing to re-sign.
But they didn't announce it yet. They didn't say that loud and clear that the deal is over.
And they should. And they should.
They should. Yeah. Not only that, they should actually. The U.S. government must call its allies to recall their ambassadors. The leaders of G7.
Because the Americans do not have an ambassador there, of course.
I know. But in my meeting with President Macron, actually I said that I was angry. I said, why did you shake the hand of Ebrahim Raisi, the butcher of Tehran? He was like, France is all about diplomacy. I said, no.
Yeah, he's the one leader that keeps calling Putin. It's true. I mean, yeah. I see it all the time, yeah.
Yeah, but I said France is also about revolution as well. You can be the first country to recognize Iran's new revolution and call your allies. Not only just saying that we stand with the people of Iran. We don't want you to stand. We want you actually to sit down and recognize the revolution and meet with the leaders of oppositions.
And he said?
He said, I'm ready to do it. Mm-hmm. So that's the real
When was
action.
That conversation?
It was in Paris, like a few weeks ago. Yeah. He was the first president who recognized the revolution.
Any steps yet to actually reach out to the opposition?
Yeah.
He has taken a step.
He actually wants me to have a delegation of opposition leaders and have a meeting and tell him what we really want.
Okay, I hope that happens.
I hope so, because the world leaders must be prepared to accept an Iran without the Islamic Republic. This is the first time in the history that President of France met with opposition. Why? I mean, even here, why President Biden don't meet with opposition leaders? They only meet with human rights activists and saying that we stand with you. It makes me angry. I don't want you to stand. Sit down and take actions, because it's unbelievable. This is a progressive revolution. Doesn't matter whether Republican are in power or Democrats. It should be a bipartisan issue, because an Iran without the Islamic Republic can make the whole world much safer place. It's good for everyone in the region.
But you don't want the Americans necessarily calling actively for regime change, in the sense that when the Iranian government is claiming that it's Saudi Arabia, it's Israel, it's the United States, it's foreign actors that are behind these demonstrations, it's not the Iranian people.
I don't want them to bring regime change for us. We're doing it.
Right.
We're doing it. What I want is very clear. When people are risking their lives and asking for regime change, you cannot patronize them and saying that, oh, this is your culture, or this is internal matter, or we don't want to touch this, by not taking strong action, sending billions of dollars to Revolutionary Guards, by keeping silent, actually, you're taking side, you know? There is a war in Iran, which being imposed on Iranian people by Islamic Republic, no? Unarmed people getting killed.
Correct.
So when the American government still want to negotiate, still not recognizing this revolution, clearly they're taking side. So I don't want the American government or any Western government bring democracy for us or regime change for us. We, the people of Iran, are doing this, and I want them to recognize this revolution and stop legitimizing one of the most barbaric regime. Is that too much to ask?
What do you think it takes to actually, domestically, to remove this regime? Are you hopeful? You said it's a marathon, but are you hopeful that this theocracy will actually crumble?
Definitely. Look, the Islamic Republic took everything away from us. Everything, everything. As we were talking, we don't even have a national team because being taken away from us. Everything, our freedom, dignity, but not hope. Not hope. Millions of people in Iran believe that the revolution already happened in their heart. They believe that they're gonna win this battle. Because for years and years, the regime was successful to create fear within the society. We always had the fear inside us. But now this is the Islamic Republic. They are scared of us. They're scared of teenagers. They're scared of schoolgirls. Can you believe that? Like schoolgirls who are being forced to cover themselves. These days, you see that they're leading the revolution by taking off their veils and waving that, burning the headscarf. And that means that, like, they're not going to be slaves anymore. They're not going to obey the mullahs anymore. This is the end for the Islamic Republic. When you see that teenagers are saying death to dictator, teenagers are saying that we don't want a religious dictatorship.
Masih, thanks for your spirit.
Thank you so much. I hope one day I really invite you to Iran.